In this video, we will be discussing the different career paths in the software engineering career paths. We have the engineering manager career path and the staff software engineer career path. Welcome to the Life at Miro YouTube channel. Let's get started. Here at Miro, we have two different career paths that you can choose as you grow in seniority at the company. The first path is the individual contributor, and this is a path in which you don't manage any people and you work as a standard software developer. The other path is the management path, in which you begin to manage teams and manage projects. When you reach these crossroads, you have to start making decisions as to which one you want to go in and which skills you want to hone. And here with me today, I have two members of our team who each took one path in the career trajectory here at Miro. So what I wanted to ask the two of you guys today is, what are the specific things that you took into consideration when picking the different paths for career progression at Miro? Ashwini?
For me, a couple of questions that I asked myself before making this decision is, in my current role, like, what are the things that I enjoy? Like, for me, switching from an IC to EM also means there are a couple of things that I might not get to do, which I'm doing today. And am I okay with letting go of things? For example, being hands-on more often as compared to while I was IC versus an EM. Like, am I okay to make that switch? Starting to think more from a bigger picture or different point of view as an EM, and also probably being open to unblock others, right? Like, that's something that I saw that I really enjoy doing more. And that's a feedback that I received, like, from my team as well. Like, to be honest, I never thought in that direction unless somebody like gave me that feedback saying, you seem to have like a good handle on unblocking people. And whenever I've come to you, like, you have given me solutions to move ahead. And that was a spark for me to say, okay, maybe like that's something that I should follow through, right? Yeah, those are some of the things that I picked up. It was definitely not a one-day decision where I woke up and I said, okay, I'm going to be an EM. But it was rather a decision that happened over time. I also spoke to a lot of people who are playing that role, or a lot of like fellow software engineers saying this is something that I'm considering. And I'm sort of feeling very comfortable where I am right now. And I'm very uncomfortable about that fact. Like, what are my options and what I should be doing to make myself uncomfortable?
And do you feel there's parts of the aspects of your role that you had before that are maybe missing now, whether it's coding or anything technical that you miss from day to day?
I definitely had a hard time when I made the switch. There were like two major things that I found it really hard. One was not being as hands-on. The second thing is the immediate sense of accomplishment being hands-on gives you, right? Like, I raise a PR and I can close my day saying, okay, I've done something today. But when I become an EM, it was not that immediate. And for a long time, I was also struggling to let go. I would still pick up tasks, but eventually I realized that's just holding my team back. And I had to learn to let go, right? And I was also frantic that, oh, I'm not part of like every decision-making that's happening like in the code level, right? Had to let go of that. Also had to realize my sense of accomplishment is if my team is successful, like that's something that I've accomplished rather than like raising a PR or deploying something.
Were there certain skills that you felt like you needed to start investing in more once you decided to make the switch?
Yes, like consciously practicing the art of letting go. And a delegation is one more thing that didn't come to me naturally when I did the switch, which is something, again, I had to learn to delegate things and also to naturally trust that your team will like do what you would have done if you were in that position, right? When you're an IC, you're like, you're always like very focused and you're also very close to your fellow engineers. So you challenge each other immediately and like you make sure things get done well as a team. But when you are an EM, first of all, like you're switching between so many things, you don't have that time to be so detail oriented. And then you're also in a position where like you challenging them might no longer mean like your colleague is challenging you. It could be micromanaging, right? So there's like a balance that you need to do, and that's something that I had to learn.
Well, everything you've said resonates with me, so I definitely agree with all of that. Yeah. And how about you, Sander? When it comes to your role, you actually have quite an interesting story in your career path at Miro. Do you mind diving into that for us a little bit?
Sure. Yeah, so when I started, I was a senior software engineer. And a few months later, let's say 6 or 8 months later, then there was a position available to become the engineering manager of that team. And for a few months, I think around 6-7 months, I was actually the engineer manager of the team. And then there was a position available to become a staff engineer. So it was a rather unique experience to both try both positions in that career path that we have. And it was there to actually let me try to see what fits best. So at first, I noticed, and it's similar to what you said, that I try to unblock the engineer. So one of the reasons for me to become an engineer manager is to look at the team and what's holding them back. Like, well, how can I accelerate their work? So how can I be a force multiplier there for them? It's important to get out of your comfort zone, right? To try this new things, learn the the more challenging aspects that, for example, letting things go or letting others like delegate. But then also try the other path, which now fits more natural to me what I want to do.
Yeah, that makes quite a lot of sense. I would actually say that there's quite a few qualities within both the staff engineer and the engineering manager that are actually, let's say, mirrored with each other that a senior engineer doesn't necessarily have. Like you said, unblocking teammates and the work that they're doing, right? Staff engineers will focus on that much more than a senior engineer would do, right? And that's very similar to a manager. Mm-hmm. I actually believe that what you said is actually one of the best qualities of working at Miro is that when you do decide to pick that path and decide to go in one direction on these crossroads, it's not final, right? If you want to move to the other path, it's entirely open to you, and you can definitely try things out here at Miro, which is something that I haven't experienced anywhere else. As a senior software engineer, when you progress in your career, you get to a point in which you need to take one of two tracks. This is generally the individual contributor track or the manager track. Right now, we're going to speak about what each one of those tracks do on a daily basis and what their work is like. Ashwini, do you want to tell me a little bit more about what it is to be an engineering manager?
Yeah, I think for me, as an engineering manager, my day-to-day work means a lot of meetings. I work in a division where we deal with a lot of integrations, which means we work with partners, which means like having conversations with them and building strategy like as a group, not just Miro, but also another product in picture, which I find very interesting in my job right now. It's also making sure your team is motivated and challenged with the kind of work that we have. And of course, in the end, we are making sure we deliver things that improves our business and eventually like adds to our vision as an organization.
Yeah, that sounds quite impactful and a fun role to have. On the other hand, Sander, how do you feel like that contrasts with your role as a staff engineer, and kind of what does your role imply?
Yeah, the role itself has different flavors in Miro. I just want to highlight that. For example, you have staff engineers that are more for alignment between the various teams or the divisions that we have. But it's also some of them are more domain experts on specific topics. So you always know who to reach out to. So there's different type of archetypes in Miro for a staff engineer. And personally, what I like about it is that one of the things is that I should be informed on a technical level why decisions have been made to make it easier for engineering managers to base their roadmap on. So I help with the strategic roadmapping on a technical level, so I can figure out what the details are, so they can align with teams, right? So this is where the interaction between the engineering manager and the staff engineer also happens. However, both are responsible and work on the roadmap, what the teams are going to do, and both should be aware what various teams do. It's, I guess, the level of detail that's different, right? And I think that's the what I actually like about it, I'm a detail-oriented person, so I actually like to dig deep into why something works like that.
What would you say your kind of day-to-day contributions into coding and architectural design, these sorts of things, how do you feel like that compares to the senior software engineer role?
Interesting. So one of the things that I find valuable is being aware of what happens in the various teams, right? So there are specific areas. And one of the things that is different from a senior engineer is that the work that you do is cross-company or cross-stream. So you work on a broader scope that doesn't really fit into one team. Right, so it's all about being aware of what happens in other areas and your neighboring teams, but also outside of it, so you spot problems before they become a problem. And as a senior engineer in a team, it's still valuable to do it, but it's not your responsibility to do so.
Ashwini, can you tell me a little bit about the way that you manage your team and their career growth and development?
I think when it comes to career growth itself, I see it with two parts. One, as a team or as like an organization, what do we expect from senior engineers? That's like one aspect to it. And the other aspect is, as an individual, like what are the things that interests you or challenges you or the skills that you want to focus on, right? So one thing that I do is like at the beginning of every quarter, because our planning is per quarter, I sort of work with the engineers to say, okay, like what is it that we want to work on in the next 3 months, like in terms of what kind of skills or challenges that you want, so that we can create such opportunities. Of course, like not all the time we would be able to create the opportunities immediately. Sometimes it's immediate. Sometimes I take these input and start looking for things around and probably like come back saying, hey, like there's this initiative that's happening. Maybe that's something which is a fit for the thing that we discussed, and then encourage them to pursue those as well. And having like frequent catch-ups and checking up on those things, and also like receiving feedback in terms of what should I do that will help them grow their career. Like it could be feedback, it could be like something else. Like those are some of the things that we do on a regular basis to ensure like each individual in the team is like following a path that they are happy with.
So Sandra, I want to ask you a little bit about what the career paths look like past the staff role. What really changes once you get into these greater roles, let's say similar to an architect?
So what I noticed is that if you want to move in that direction, then it's about risk, for example, and impact. And the bigger the project is also the higher the risk becomes to deliver it, for example, in a year of time. And what you notice is that these projects become also of a bigger impact for the company. And that could be an area where you grow in an IC track as a staff engineer to a principal architect, for example.
Do you think that reflects what things are like in the engineering manager role also, Ashwini?
I mean, it's a yes and no, because I think in the management role, at least like this is my perception of what I'm seeing around me, right? You start looking at things from even more bigger picture and your impact is different. You also get or go a bit more farther away from, I would say, like really low level technical aspects of things, and you start managing various other aspects of business that you might not be exposed to before, like budget. You have to work with certain budget, or even ensuring how do you deliver whatever you as a team or a bigger group of teams that you want to deliver, and how do you want to divide like the capacity that you have. It becomes more strategical, and you're also much more held accountable, I would say, as opposed to just like being like in my level where your scope and deliverable is smaller, but as you move up the ladder, it becomes bigger and bigger and you become busier and busier.
I wanted to ask you another question specifically around kind of mentoring and career development of engineers. As a staff engineer, I know that you get some opportunities to help grow those who are under you. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yes. So what we try to do is also to provide certain initiatives in Miro where I can help senior engineer with driving the initiative. It's a technical initiative and generally could be outside, for example, that team, but it has a lot of impact, for example, on technical debt. And it helps them to grow career-wise more in a staff engineer position. So it helps them develop the skills where I take the guardrails off, but where they can drive the initiative to completion.
So I want to ask you both a bit about those particular aspects of your role that you really enjoy and you think play on your strengths. Ashwini, what do you think?
I think for me, the exposure that I get to business side of things is really interesting for me, because that helps me draw a full picture of why I'm doing what I'm doing right now. And also the fact that in my current role, I get to work with cross-functional teams like marketing, customer support, or in my role, I also work with partner teams. So that's a different kind of exposure that I've got, which I'm enjoying as well. It also pushes to think a bit more broadly when it comes to growth, because I'm not just like focusing on my growth anymore, but my whole team as well. Of course, like I mentioned earlier, unblocking people and trying to find, you know, simple solutions for complex problem is something that I really enjoy doing. It feels like, wow, I did something really good today and I can feel happy about it.
That's great. How about you, Sander?
It's interesting that you mentioned simple problems for complex solutions, because that's definitely something I always try to aim for as well. And the difficulty, at least in the software engineering role for me, is that there's always many solutions or potential solutions. And to know what's simple, you also need to have an estimate of the impact. And this is where a personal trait for me comes in, that I'm both analytical and results driven. So I try by nature to look what is the impact if I do so. And then I try to pick the simplest one that has the impact that we want, right? So it's both estimation and picking something simple so we can move forward.
And with that, we've reached the end of this video. If you have any more questions about software engineering career paths, please place those below in the comments. And if you like this video, please like and subscribe to this channel.